And now, ladies and gentlemen, we are moving forward to our next segment, which is the panel discussion. But before that, I'd like to once again thank our partners, our presenting partner, ZeeFi, India's number one contact brand, and our digital growth partner, InMobi, driving real connections. Moving on to the panel discussion for the day, the theme of the panel is how mobile has become the marketer's resilient channel. Our session chair for the panel is Mr. Gulraiz Alam, Chief Investment and Strategy Officer at Affle. He's the Chief Investment and Strategy Officer at Affle Holdings. He has over 15 years of experience and drives Affle's strategy and investment decisions with an inspiring entrepreneurial journey behind him. Gulraiz now divides his time across geographies and uses his extensive experience in extending the company's offerings to key clients across industries. So I'm going to welcome you first, Gulraiz Alam. Very warm welcome to you. And I'm going to leave the screen over to you to get the panelists on board and get the conversation going.
Thank you. Thank you, Kathy. I hope I'm audible and there's no echo.
No, absolutely. You're clearly audible.
Perfect. So thank you once again. And I also want to thank Exchange for Media for giving me this opportunity. Well, it doesn't happen every day that you've got five brand marketers on the panel. So without any further delay, let me start inviting the guests for this evening. And I will do that in the alphabetical order. First, I have Anil Vishwanathan. Anil has about 20 years of experience, and he's the one responsible for feeding us chocolates as sweet for the last 12 years. Anil works at Mondelez International as the senior director, and Anil is also passionate about building brands that people love, and it's clearly visible in the work that he does. Welcome, Anil.
Thank you, Gulraiz. Happy to be here.
Pleasure to have you. Next, I have Karti Marshall, and I fondly call him Karti sir. He has over 32 years of experience. He's been with Kotak Mahindra Bank for over 14 years now. Currently working as the president and CMO for Kotak Mahindra Bank, and he also believes in using words to make a difference. Karti sir?
Hi, Gulraiz. Hi, Anil. Hi, Kathy. Thanks for having me.
Pleasure to have you, sir. All right. Next, I have Manish Kalra. Manish has 20 years of experience across various industries. He started his careers with ITC, moved to Citibank, Pepsi, Dell, Make My Trip, and the list goes on. Currently, he's working with Z5 as the head of marketing for Avon. Manish is passionate about understanding online user behavior and photography.
Hey, guys. Happy to be here, Gulraiz. Thank you so much for doing this.
Thanks, Manish. A pleasure to have you. And next, I have the lovely ladies, Pallavi Singh. She's been in the automotive industry for over 13 years. She started with Yamaha, moved on to Harley Davidson, where I believe she was the first person to be hired in India, and she was there right from the beginning. Moved on to MG and now at BMW. Pallavi is passionate about riding and technology which delivers seamless customer experience.
Thanks, Gulraiz, and happy to be here.
Pleasure to have you, Pallavi. And finally, I have Sujata. Sujata has about 25 years of experience, started from P&G, Nokia, RVS, Coke, and now working as the head of marketing for India and South Asia at Visa. Sujata, very surprisingly, and it was a good surprise to know that is a lead vocalist in a rock band. And if you're lucky, you can catch her live in concert at Hard Rock Mumbai or Hard Rock Delhi.
Hi, Gulraiz. Good to be here.
Good to be happy. All right. I typically start my panel discussion with a fun question. So here it is. And I promise you, this is the only one which is a common question to all of you. The question is, apart from your own brand, which is the best mobile campaign that you remember, typically from the last 6 to 12 month range, and why? Apart from your own brand, which is the most memorable mobile advertising campaign that you remember, and why? In the time frame of last 6 to 12 months. And let me start with the lovely ladies. Pallavi, do you want to take that first?
You've put me on a spot. I think I personally liked, the one which Royal Enfield launched, and because I'm into riding, so I think that's the only one I remember. They launched their experiential platform on mobile. And that's a great customer experience platform for community. I think that's the one. And the second one is the Starbucks India campaign, which they launched just 6 months back. I think those two ones kind of strike the chord for me.
Perfect. Sujata?
Okay, and I'm not saying this because Anil is on the panel, but I really loved what Cadbury's just did, I think a week ago, where they got a lot of the SMEs onto the platform with their advertising. I thought that was a beautiful brand, brought in the need of the hour and just struck a chord with me.
I'm going to talk about that later. It's called Cadbury, not just an ad.
Yes.
All right. Anil, apart from your own brands.
I think there's lots of interesting work that's going on, Gulraj. And I think from my perspective, specifically on mobile, slightly different, but I'm quite pleased at the work that Lifebuoy and Closeup have been doing in the rural markets, specifically leveraging mobile and kind of addressing some very specific core problems in rural market, which typically any other form of media finds it difficult. So the work that Lifebuoy is doing on sanitation and Closeup is doing on oral hygiene, leading the industry in the kind of work that they do.
I agree. Karthi, sir?
I'll pick a campaign I saw Axis Bank do early on during COVID called Reverse the Khata, where they triggered the sentiment among all of us to pay it forward, so to speak, to all the small and medium businesses who were struggling because of loss of business, like your barber and your Chaiwala, Tapri Chaiwala, and so on and so forth. I thought that was outstanding and inspirational work.
And it's amazing to see you complimenting a community brand.
We did it publicly as well. We tweeted about it at the time.
Yeah. All right, Manish.
So I would go with IKEA when they launched in Hyderabad, and they kind of created a buzz around it. They could configure furniture and they had auto rickshaws, and it was pretty 361, but mobile was the lead in which they could allocate a specific model of furniture. So loved what they did.
Oh yeah, absolutely. All right, so the topic for today, mobile marketing. Let me start with Sujata. Sujata, you've got such a vast experience of 25 years, and I'm sure you would have seen the entire evolution of not only mobile, but digital as a channel, right? And today we talk about mobile being most effective media for marketing. So let me ask your opinion on how do you see this perceived effectiveness of mobile as a marketing channel?
Well, you're right, Gurez. We've really come a long way from, TV, where we had a single channel, to cable, to digital, social, and today mobile. So we've seen growth like never before. And if you ask me about reach and efficacy of mobile, it's quite insane to see the growth. Today we have 700 million internet users in India, and that's up from 300 million just 5 years ago. So you look at the scale of the growth. Out of that 700 million, 582 million are on mobile. So I think the topic of is reach there, that's an absolute yes. And why this reach is there so much, I think, is because of the second point, which is it's so efficient. And I'm just going to talk about four quick points before I hand over. But the first one is, I don't think any one of us, even when we're on this panel, doesn't have our phone next to us. So the accessibility of mobile is that. And see, everyone's looking at their phone and smiling. So exactly that. So it's with us all the time. We're always looking at it. So because of that, more time is spent on mobile and we watch more content on mobile. The second is it's also very cost effective. You reach a huge number of people, but in far less the cost that it would be for mass media advertising. And the third, I think, for a brand like ours, which is really important, is you get very, very effective targeting. So mobile devices and their IDs are unique for each customer. So we can actually leverage that data to do location-based activity, proximity targeting, and actually personalize the content. And being able to do that, therefore, allows a brand, and Visa does that a lot with our customers, to actually have interactive advertising based on what you're doing at that time and where you are and what offers can be relevant to you. So net-net, very, very high reach and very, very high efficiency.
Fantastic. I think I'm going to talk a lot more about those three points. But one point that I want to touch upon is building brand on the mobile. We can reach the audience. And is it possible to build a brand? So for that, let me take is from Anil. Anil, we all love the emotional appeal, right? I mean, be it the Kuch Khaas Hai campaign or Kuch Meetha Ho Jaye campaign, it was fantastic. But what I want to know is, from your perspective, how difficult it is to translate this storytelling or your brand proposition on that small device on the small screen?
Great question, Gulraj. And I think, it can be as difficult or easy as any other medium. I think fundamentally, the trick is to start with the consumer and try and understand what the consumer is doing at that medium. And I think all of us brand marketers have gone through the journey of first starting to adapt what we've created for some other medium into some other medium, and it's not worked. And over a period of time, we started to get platform first. So similar to the same story applies for mobile as well. And I think the moment you realize that the nature of storytelling has to change, I think there's something that clicks. And when you start looking at insights of what the consumer is doing in the medium, then you start finding out ways in which you can build your brand differently from the classical way of storytelling. So I think that's where the penny drops, Gulraj. And I think it's not difficult, it's just that the nature of building brands changes. It's no longer about storytelling, but it's possibly about a two-way engagement, and where you're able to personalize, but you're also open to receiving feedback. And I think that two-way storytelling, a two-way engagement is, I guess, the way to build brands as against storytelling. I think storytelling with any form of, you know, length of the asset or type of the asset tends to be self-limiting in that sense, because the brand is trying to communicate and not trying to engage. So just use an example of what we did last year with this activity called Purple Heart. Typically during Friendships Day is a big moment for us, but you know, the Gen Zers use chocolate to exchange, you know, Friendship Day and all that. Classically, we should do a typical TV ad, right? But when it came to mobile and digital, I think when we said we don't want to do a video content, how do we engage? Working with the partners, working with what's happening in the medium, you then come up with an insight like cyberbullying. And cyberbullying is kind of such a topical subject for the Gen Zers. And then you see that there's a great opportunity to talk about it and build your brand around that. And then we created the Purple Heart campaign on mobile, celebrating Friendship Day, but a very different spin. Right? You're able to build your brand, you're able to engage with your consumer and leverage that occasion in a very different way. So I think the core is to go consumer first, understand what they're doing in the medium, and then try and engage with them, as against look at classical storytelling. I think that's what we are realizing. Obviously, it's a big pivot. A lot needs to change. The whole ecosystem changes. And you know, our whole partners need to kind of operate in a way which is different, but it works in a different way.
Interestingly, Anil, you mentioned about the way we are able to personalize the content, right? My next question is to Manish, and given the vast experience, Manish, you have, that's the reason I'm asking this question, that given the way we can target the ability to segment, dissect, define audience, create customer cohorts, it's like unparalleled to any other media, right? Do you believe that capability itself pushes us into a deeper funnel bucket, right? Most of the brand marketers don't talk to mobile advertising firms about building brands, just talk about more about performance. Do you think that ability to customize communication, segment, create custom cohorts pushes us in the deeper funnel segment?
I would say it pushes us towards targeting the right audience in a more effective way. It could be top funnel, it could be deeper funnel, depending on the goals of the campaign or the marketer. Like you rightly said, there is no other medium in the country which gives you this kind of targeting. You can target me by my geography, by my device type, my interest, my age group, anything and everything that defines me as an individual. You can find my behavior online. So if you want to kind of target me with a brand campaign, video is a great available medium. Like Anil said, what kind of video you show? How you make it effective in the first 10 seconds, how do you show the core story moments in the first 15 seconds, how does it catch attention, makes you take an action. That's a great brand building medium. And you can kind of gamify it, you can come up with new ideas which engages with the youth or the middle-aged guy or anyone in that spectrum. If you want a bottom funnel campaign, obviously, there are like ways like CPC. So I come from e-commerce and completely online world. You can go hardcore CPC campaigns. You can hardcore cost per transaction campaigns. I'm sure Sujata does a lot of cost per lead campaigns, so does Karthi and everyone. So you can kind of define the core deliverables for this medium and then optimize your creative, your targeting, your medium accordingly. But I think I wanted to jump in your first question. Mobile is the only advertising medium for me, man. I would go to TV when everyone else has gone away. So for the last so many years, while I spent a lot of money when I was building Amazon brand in India, and I think those were crazy days. But for the last two, 3 years, it's just been mobile. And that's where you find the audience, and that's where you find effectiveness, and that's where you find targeting. And that's how I believe the entire online world, as well as our marketer community, is going to evolve. Obviously, Anil and all, they are also going after a broader audience. But let's say for likes of Sujata, which is Visa, which is targeted, you want a high-profile person. Same for Karthi. And obviously, Pallavi should not advertise anywhere else. So I'm kind of very clear that, hey, this is the audience. And just to give you one perspective, since we are Z5, after COVID, we realized almost 50% of our views have moved to connected devices. When I say connected devices, it's TVs. It's like big screen, families watching, and you can now target a family with online medium, which is affluent family, obviously, which can afford a kind of a high-end product. But I can go on, and you have to be kind of pulling me in here.
You know, I was telling the Exchange for Media team that I can spend an hour with each one of you individually. So it's a huge task to make sure that, you know, we get the relevant points out of this 1 hour. All right, let me move to Karthi, sir. Karthi, sir, you started your career with a mainline agency, and that too from the creative background, right? So do you think on the mobile device, when we are advertising, that creativity or that aspirational angle, we talked about segmentation, we talked about targeting smaller groups, is that more challenging because now you've got to come up with creativity for that smaller cohort and not one vast audience? Or the creativity gets limited? What's your take on it?
No, I think like many wise men and women before me have said, creativity is, I think, best generated when there are guardrails and constraints, right? The more you squeeze the pipe, the more creative people are required to get. And I would say that the constraints placed by the small screen actually have, it's taken time, of course, we've all taken time to learn the medium. But if I could illustrate with a plug for my brand, early this year during COVID, we had the opportunity not just to shoot on mobile, because our model Ranveer Singh was sitting at home, our director was sitting at his home, our creative director was sitting at his home, and so were we. But we shot for a product and a service of the bank, which is delivered completely via the mobile, which is the account opening experience. So for us, the joy of all those boxes, essentially all of them singing from the same hymn book, so to speak, which is that a product, which is completely the product and the brand and the experience and the communication, everything. So, you know, like when we were growing up, the four P's were all over the place. But today, every single P is in that device. There is nowhere else, like Manish is so eloquently expressing. It's not just about the advertising, but what you asked about the brand also, the brand is the brand experience. And the brand experience is now largely, for most of us, it's on the device. Even for Pallavi, the bulk of the brand experience is while the person is sitting in the car, what are they doing in the car? 99% of the time they are on a device. So that opportunity to have the mobile integrated with every single thing you do, I think, is enormous today. I'll stop now.
Thank you, sir. Time. You know, talking about these creative ways and moving on to Pallavi, I mean, seriously, launching the BMW.in where you can buy the car online. Typically, you know, we're used to buying groceries from our mobile phone. And today you can buy a luxury car on the phone or on your device. That was super awesome, with more creative ways. Tell us more about that experience.
No, I think, you know, I just want to jump in quickly. I'm in a little bit of a remote location, so my background is a bit of a lake. If you can see, it's splashy. So I was actually riding from Manali, so a bit of a challenge with the network. But I just want to add, I think most importantly for mobile marketing is the people who strategize. And today the world has changed. The way marketers used to advertise before is very different. There's a lot to do with, and I'm a big fan of technology, which leads to automation and customer experience. So when we at BMW were looking at, you know, when COVID hit all of us, we still wanted to be close to our customers and not want to sell, but just to tell them that we are here to serve them. And that's when we launched something called the BMW Contactless Experience. And it was across the entire spectrum of the business, which is sales, service, after sales, most importantly, after sales, because most of the people weren't driving their cars, right? What they wanted was that once when the showrooms open and the after service starts, our cars should be taken care of. I mean, I think that's what automotive is all about, take care of the post-purchase experience and pre-purchase experience. And I think that's what mobile has done for us. We launched the entire contactless experience with the whole objective of serving the customer like any other brand like Visa would do. Primarily, I can relate to that from that perspective. Our customers and clientele would want everything at a click of a button. My car is serviced. I want to see my car while it's being serviced, that what parts are being changed. Are we clear with them? Is the communication, what we are changing is as per the price we are quoting. I think now mobile marketing is all about transparency, especially in a luxury segment, because these customers expect everything at a click of a button. And most times it's about, they are truly our brand ambassadors, right? So they expect much more than what we can sometimes deliver. But that's been the whole journey since COVID hit. And I think digital transformation and mobile marketing has just accelerated its pace for marketers of tomorrow, but marketers of today. And we're all learning in that phase. But for us, the most important thing, and personally, I think as a marketer and a professional, has been how do you join all the businesses, not just marketing? Marketing is a function to support the end goal of sales. How do we bring everybody together in an organization to understand what this little device can do for us? Because automotive in general is extremely traditional sector, but we had to launch something which was more progressive, but more importantly, bringing the entire business unit together, not just marketing as a function, because then it's isolation and it doesn't deliver on the business goals. So I think, I added lots of facets
this
together.
This small device that you talked about, Pallavi, also gives us one more ability, which we call location, right? So from pervasive to proximity. And Sujata mentioned about it earlier. I want to take your thoughts, because this is a perfect use case for proximity advertising. We've seen some jewelry brands doing it, some luxury brands doing it. In fact, Toyota does it very nicely in most parts of the world. What's your strategy in India on proximity advertising? Pallavi, that's for you.
Can you hear me?
Yes,
I did get the question. I think if I were to look at proximity advertising, that's something which has been happening for a long time now, specifically when it comes to luxury segment. It's hyper-targeting, to be honest. It's not just about proximity, but it's about how much personalization can we do, where we can talk to our customers, not just from a point of selling, but also from a point of telling them that we are here to serve them, like I was saying. So it's about hyper-targeting and not just proximity targeting for us. For us, the most important touch point still remains the dealer, because it's a physical manifestation of a product when it comes to automotive in general. So the facet still remains the same. So until unless augmented reality becomes AR, VR as a solution becomes really massive for India, I think that's where the leap of faith as manufacturers we will all take to ensure that we are able to serve the customer wherever they are, whether in the living room, whether in the kitchen, or maybe in their PlayStation sitting somewhere. So I guess this is proximity is something which has been happening for a long time. I think the true ability to create experiences for consumers of tomorrow and consumers of today will come from automating the AR VR solutions together to bring seamless customer experience across value chain. And that happens only through mobile today, which are primarily virtual showrooms, also experiencing your car sitting in your living room or maybe anywhere you would want to do. So I would package it in from a luxury experience point of view very differently.
All right, thanks, Pallavi. Talking about the proximity, how can I forget? Anil, congratulations on that campaign, man. It was fantastic. You just took the, not just a Cadbury ad, to a different level of proximity advertising. Tell us more about that and any other plans of any other innovations on proximity advertising.
Yeah, I mean, this is an idea. I mean, obviously we didn't think of it as proximity advertising. I think the core of it came from kind of the brand purpose of generosity and how can we think about ways and means in which we can land our purpose in a meaningful way. I think quite often when it comes to purpose, it's a tricky territory where, you know, you need to be sure about what you're doing and be clear that you're able to achieve what you want to do. So I think, and we've been talking about generosity for a while, Gulwes. So whether it was the thank you activation that we did earlier in the year with the thank you bars and stuff that we've done in IPL. And then we said, okay, what can we do? And of course, a brilliant idea came from our creative partners of saying, you know, what can we do for our retailers? And can we create an ad which involves them as And of course, as we played around with it, I think the idea was to then engage with our partners, Facebook and Google, and get them in and see, you know, how can we kind of conceive and can, is this possible? Thankfully, it was possible. I think the big risk was whether we'd be able to land it because it was in August and we wanted to land it. Diwali doesn't change, right? So we had to make it happen by Diwali. And the risk was whether we'll have egg on our face by trying to say something which is generic and not, you know, not specific enough. So the kudos to the team that then came together, Wavemaker, our media agency, Delta X, the guys who gave the solution, and of course Facebook and Google as well. And I think, we knew it was very interesting, but I think also seems like it caught the pulse of the feeling of gratitude that I think all of us are having, especially in the festive context, to give. And if we are secure and have the privilege of being secure, then what can we do to kind of include and involve others? So I think that's what they tapped into. Then once you got into the interesting things is, of course, you know, the local retailers and then actually having to go physically to them and take the legal approval. And not everybody, and obviously everybody was curious, kya kare ho bhai, hamara naam leke kya karoge, etc., etc. So we had to go actually store by store and convince them because it was something that didn't work. So it required a fair amount of legwork at the back end. So like in classic art style, you know, we're always realizing there's nothing like truly online or truly offline. It's getting more and more, you know, integrated in that sense. So we had to work in the back end so that it looks, you know, kind of sleek in the front end. I mean, there's, I think the other interesting anecdote was that, you know, once we hosted the ad, we got so many irate people saying, yeah, I went and saw the video, I'm not getting it. So we had to tell them that it's a server-based ad and you get to see it only when you're served it. So that's when we then created the other solution where we had a drop-down list. So you can go and select your PIN code, so just be sure that you're not fibbing. You're actually doing something which is tech-based. Quite interesting. I think we do see there's a potential to scale it up further. We did this during Diwali, which is based in the north and the west. So we do see, you know, why not take it to the wider country? Kind of, I mean, the options are unlimited. And what's good is where can we take this idea? So that's the power of learning. Where can we take it? And, you know, once we have a great idea, I think you have an opportunity to keep scaling it up.
Look, I was saying kudos to the team who executed it in such a short span of time. Great. Sujata, I mean, you have great amount of offline data, right? About every customer, consumer, buying pattern, transaction. Tell us more about how would you layer the offline data with the online data and try and use it for mobile marketing campaigns?
So a couple of things. Firstly, Anil, like I said, I thought it was a beautiful idea. We actually, and what it did is more than just giving. You're actually helping small and medium entrepreneurs during this time. At Visa, we have a campaign called Where You Shop Matters, which is really among the similar lines. So we'll touch base on that, really talking about that. Gurus, actually, I want to tell you one thing. The data doesn't lie with us. It actually lies with the likes of Karthi. We don't hold customer data. The bank, you know, we partner with our banks and we partner and they have the data. We actually don't have the data. But what we do is, we are able to use a lot of signals and we use proximity and we layer that on top of that. So for example, Pallavi talked about contactless. So contactless has been our biggest focus for the last year or so. And what we're able to do solely on the mobile, and we've seen huge success prior to COVID and now that people are stepping out again and it's happening, is that when while you do a mass media generic campaign, what you can do is layer it. So for example, we tied up with one of the biggest retail outlets in the country, and every time you were about 500 meters in the radius of that outlet, any outlet in the country, so it was that well targeted, you got an offer on your mobile saying if you use your contact list, you get 5% off. The moment you went closer and you went 100 meters, it became you get 10% off. And when you were 10 meters radius, which is like literally you had to be at the door of the store, you got a 15% off and using that. And what we saw, there was a growth of more than four times in the usage of contactless cards during that period. So we use signals like that. But like I said, we actually don't get customer data. And I think Karthi is the best person to talk about how they use customer data, because we partner with them, but we don't get that.
Was this execution based on beacon, Bluetooth, or how was that executed?
Yeah, so it was based on, it was a combination of local beacons as well as Bluetooth and a wider range thing. So you can do it for about 1 kilometer radius. So we did 500, 100, and 10 meters. And it was amazing because the customers who came and said, we kept wondering, like, you know, when we get to the cash counter, is that 15 going to go to 30? Because we kept raising it as we went closer and closer. So that was an interesting one.
Well, that is very interesting. In fact, some of you mentioned about the connected TV. So let me ask Manish, jumping topics from proximity to connected TV. And since he's the expert from Z5, Manish, how have you seen the growth of connected TVs in India? I know in USA, it's already on the track to exceed linear TVs. Do you see a similar trend? And what sort of percentage of your subscriber base is coming from connected TVs?
Yeah, like I said, COVID has been a shot in the arm on connected TV viewing. Families got together, they didn't have anything to go out to, and cinemas were closed. So we saw the base was pretty small. So it was a 5x growth in the households who were watching on connected TV pre and post COVID. Right now, almost 15 to 20% of our traffic comes from connected TVs, and these are pretty much households. We also have And just to give you guys some example, because India is moving fast, almost 25% of our audience is cord cutters. These guys don't have traditional TV at home, and they're pretty much, Anil is raising hand. So they're pretty much on OTT platforms, and they're watching all their content online. So what we have done using technology is, again, very targeted connected TV reach. And we also have a lot of live channels. So live TV channels you can watch on our app on connected TVs. And there we can give a lot of targeting capabilities to like luxury advertisers. That segment, just to give you an example, is completely sold out. I mean, we get 100% booking advance of the month that take connected TV targeted ads. We want to run DAI. DAI is digital dynamic ad insertions. And it just replaces the TV feed with targeted feeds. But to your point, that segment is now 15% growing the fastest. Their binging habits are pretty high. I mean, I won't give you exact numbers, but it ranges significantly in hours and pretty much almost 30 to 40% higher than a mobile consumer, because it's a family, you're at comfort, you're not kind of watching it on your own. So yeah, that's the future. And while we have been obviously banking big on mobile handsets and smartphone growth, and that'll keep driving the growth. But as evolution happens in more purchasing power, better devices coming in, and obviously the prices of connected TVs are going down. If you see the latest range from your likes of Redmi or your OnePlus, I mean, they're selling smart TVs at like $15,000, 30-inch screens. What else do you want? So yeah, India is moving fast in that direction, and it's enabled by likes of our friends in Jio, who are obviously providing very fast data speeds at low cost. And some data speaks for you. I mean, connected TV households are like consuming 3 to 4 GB per day, and kind of on the forefront of internet revolution in India. So yes, that's the space to be, and we are completely geared up to their experience. And from our side, even the product design, we have a separate team for connected TV. We have a separate team for mobile phones, and so that we can provide the best of consumer experience to these online users, who are obviously the affluent part of the country. So yeah, it's the next thing to go after.
Absolutely, and I'm glad you mentioned about Jio. I have a question for the audience. In 2016, there was a research conducted out of 160 countries. India was at number 159 in terms of data consumption, right? Out of 160, we were 159. 1 year after the Jio launch, which is, let's say, 2018 or 2017, can anybody in the audience tell me where are we in terms of data consumption in the world, per capita data consumption? I'll wait for your answers. In the meantime, Anil, any experiences on connected TVs?
Yes, and I think definitely seeing an opportunity for some parts of our portfolio where we've been struggling for a period of time in terms of being a bit more focused and targeted. And, you know, we've always struggled with mainstream there. And that's where I think we're seeing some definite benefits. I mean, it's early days, but from a cost and efficiency standpoint, but at least from a indexing to our target audience and some things which typically are kind of emerging as high growth niches for us, where our typical mass marketing approach will not work. We are seeing opportunities in connected TVs and, you know, kind of mediums where we can get these consumers who consume things like dark chocolate or sugar-free, or, you know, things are which are emerging as high-growth niches, which cannot be ignored any further. So I think some of this is also getting accelerated through COVID. So I think That's the time where mass marketers like us are realizing that a cookie-cutter approach will not work. So that's where it's coming handy, but still lots to learn. And of course, pretty much similar to the way we've approached the whole space, we've embraced it and working with partners. So, we do have some experiences of working with partners there, some with DeFi as well. So I think we are seeing opportunities. I think the other bit is regional. And I think I was listening in as a bit early, and the previous session was talking about, the whole emergence of vernacular and regional. And that's the other trend, right? Where for mass markets, we're starting to look at going deeper and deeper, and we're seeing the need to be more vernacular and localized in the way we adapt our messaging. There again, we're seeing an opportunity. So I think both at kind of very deep segments linked to kind of mass markets as well as the premium end of the market, you're seeing significant use cases emerge. Obviously, not yet as efficient, but emerging.
Right. Karthi sir, we spoke about COVID, right? I mean, it has totally changed the distribution channel. And even during the lockdown, banks, financial institutions were working. What's your take on post-lockdown consumers, especially for your banking industry?
So I don't know if we are in a post-lockdown scenario yet, frankly. My colleagues in the branches and at the front line have been equal to soldiers like the policemen or the nurses and the doctors. So I salute them, obviously. And at every institution, every financial institution in this country, they've, customers, whenever they absolutely needed to come to a branch, have come and they've been served. But I think what we've used COVID to do is to more aggressively digitize even more. And like I said, we launched the ability for you to open your account completely virtually, where even the KYC is being done remotely now. Therefore, there is no need to meet physically at all, zero contact therefore. So on the back of that, what we are seeing, so for example, one of the things we were concerned about was that our acquisition channel, which is used to be largely physical, what would they do now that customers also will be wary of meeting them physically? The interesting thing that we experimented with and it just exploded was that our salespeople innovated on their own. They took our digital account opening tools, they sent URLs to their leads and their referrals, and they handheld them over the phone for account opening. And we saw effectively organic acquisition, therefore at near zero cost, except for the intervention of our own salespeople, who were, in some sense of the word, sitting idle because they were not able to hit the street and meet customers. But they were effectively meeting customers virtually. And therefore, we see that as an example of a, like Anil also mentioned, that there is no truly online. This offline plus online marriage has allowed us to get far more efficient and effective, and it has also allowed us to keep our sales force employed gainfully, for example. And we are ideating on the back of this, even really arcane products like a mortgage, which involves enormous amount of reams of paperwork. What we have done now is digitized a large percentage of it so that at least your approval for your home loan is happening online completely. It's only when you need to get the check that we are moving to some paperwork. Even that, we are working on trying to see how we can digitize that. The thing is, the magic for us, unlike, say, Anil's product, is that our product actually has always been digital. It is our industry slothfulness that we have allowed so much of paper to proliferate. The only physical thing that needed to exist, even today needs to exist, is actually the card. There is no other thing that needs to exist in a physical form. So I think the meme about COVID being the biggest agent provocator for digital transformation has been true for our industry for sure. And I'm glad it happened.
It is for most of us. All right, I've got a lot of questions for you guys, but I'm afraid we only have 10 minutes. So let me do one thing. When, a lot of industry friends ask me to ask the few questions, it doesn't happen that five brand marketers are on a panel, and you guys are part of hunting list for a lot of people. So I'm going to be slightly innovative. I've created a small section, which I call Marketers Rapid Fire. And I also have a small gift hamper. Okay. One of you should get it, and you've got to give me top of your mind answers for it. One line answers, one word answers, but top of your mind. Who wants to go first? Let me go with the lady first. Sujata, are you ready?
Sure. Yep, I am.
Okay. First advertising dollars to TV, YouTube, OTT, or programmatic advertising?
YouTube.
Is your competition spending more money or less money on mobile compared to your own brand? On mobile.
On what? On mobile, you said?
Okay.
I think equal.
These are more merchant centric or customer centric?
We are both. We focus very much on our client partners and the merchants. Like I said,
what's
we have
the biggest challenge with mobile advertising? Ad viewability or ad fraud or any other?
Ad viewability, I don't think is an issue anymore. I think in our industry, you know, the fraud levels and stuff are things
right.
We have to deal with.
Any plans of launching Visa advertising solutions in India?
We actually already have, you know, in the hub. So we will be bringing it here soon. So
all right, very quickly pick one. Contactless payments or digital wallet?
Contactless.
Bigger competition in India in terms of RuPay or MasterCard?
Actually, the biggest competition is cash, and we are all combating, you know, to make India go cashless. So I'd say we all work together.
Good answer. Mobile advertising for branding or for performance?
Performance.
Global campaigns in India or Indian campaigns to global for Visa?
Indian campaigns. Everything we do is we create here locally.
Consumer education or brand building advertising?
Consumer education. Everyone knows what Visa is, but they don't know what it is. So how do you use it? How do you stay safe, secure? So education any day.
And last question to you. Credit card penetration in India now and in 5 years?
Credit card is just going to be at the top, and lots of other forms of digital payments and cashless payments as well.
All right. Fantastic. I'm sure you did very well. Starting from.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Here goes the first one. What percentage of your traffic comes from mobile versus desktop?
Remarkably large percentage comes from desktop even now. Surprisingly.
Okay. Would you use mobile marketing for,
particularly the account acquisition journey, we're finding that people are using web much more than they're using the download of the app, which is an insight I think that is useful to others as well, that people are holding back on downloading the app until they're sure. So that's certainly a counterintuitive insight that we've gained.
That's correct. I think for most of the financial institutions, it's still largely web. Yeah. All right. Would you use mobile marketing for performance or for branding?
Both. But obviously, much more for performance, but certainly branding as well.
All right. Would you invest in a CDP for customizing the communication or a better analytics platform?
I think first analytics, and then we'll get to the customization.
Okay. Do you think it's time to launch digital only banking products in India?
We've been at it since 2013. We launched the world's first hashtag-based banking product. So our product is, and in fact, 811 is a digital-only product. We added the debit card because we knew that batteries still die.
Got it. First, a pick one. First, advertising dollars to mobile advertising or mainline advertising?
Now mobile.
Customized creative or consumer privacy?
Consumer privacy, certainly. So at the cohort level, customized.
Campaign analytics or only ROI?
Campaign analytics or?
Only ROI. I'm not bothered about what happened in the campaign. Show me the ROI.
No, bit of both. Both.
Bit of both, okay. English ads or vernacular?
Oh, Indian. Indian cost
per lead.
Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
Cost per lead or cost per acquisition?
Cost per acquisition.
Okay, customer acquisition or customer retention from Kotak's app?
We are a challenger brand. Like Facebook likes to say, we are 1% players. So I think acquisition is our bigger challenge. So we are very hungry for customer base. Therefore, retention takes a relatively backseat, but we spend a lot of energy on it.
All right. And the last question for you, artificial reality or voice enabled services or creatives, which has a better future?
My guess is voice enabled, but hard to say.
All right. Thank you very much, sir. You did very well. Okay, let's go ahead with Anil. Anil, first question. First, advertising dollars to TV, YouTube, OTT, or programmatic?
TV.
Is mobile advertising a key metric on your management dashboard till the management level? Is mobile advertising a key metric on your management? Yeah. What's the biggest challenge for mobile advertising?
Okay. Oh, I thought there was going to be a choice. fraud.
All right. Listen to this one. Is it a good choice to move programmatic advertising in-house?
No.
For your brand, do you believe in view-through attribution or only click-through attribution? That's one of the biggest challenges that we face in the industry.
VTRs.
VTRs. All right. Pick one. E-commerce marketplace or direct to consumers?
DTC.
Connected TV or linear TV?
Connected.
Cadbury or Oreo?
Both.
Mobile branding or mobile performance?
Both.
Higher CPMs or ad fraud? They're inversely proportional.
Higher CPMs.
Targeting through cookies or device IDs?
Device IDs.
Fantastic. That was great. And finally, to Manish.
Yes, sir.
Manish, how often do you review your mobile stats?
10 times a day.
Fantastic. That's a good answer. Bigger revenue potential, AVOD or SVOD?
Both are equal in India.
Okay. As per your estimates, average number of OTT platforms on an Indian metro consumer?
3.
Okay. Future of shoppable content on the OTT platform in India?
Very high.
Okay, pick one. Short format video or the long format?
We're doing both. So yeah, both.
Okay, Hindi or vernacular content on the OTT?
Hindi leads, vernacular is the future. That's where the growth is coming.
All right. impression level transparency or ad viewability?
I think both matter to a marketer. Viewability, like Anil mentioned, VTRs are very important. So we are focused on driving viewability, and impressions obviously are important.
All right. OTT specific content or the TV content on the OTTs, which would you rate higher?
So TV acquires, and OTT specific content gives us subscriptions.
Perfect. Number of OTT players in India in the next 5 years?
I think there'll be 10 or 12, but like I said, the market would be concentrated with top 3 or 4. That's the international trend.
All right, and the last question, this is a tricky one for you, Manish. Ad spend's effectiveness on Z or Z5?
I think objectives are different, but Z5 is more effective in cost per reach or cost per transaction, if you look at it from that way, and very targeted. So yeah, as you evolve, as your advertising goals evolve, it's a function of where you want to be. But yeah, effectiveness and efficiency is higher on digital versus TV.
Fantastic. I think most of my guests did very well. And I think I'll give a hamper to all of you, not just one of you. You guys did very well. And I think we've done with the time. Request to audience, do let me know how did you like, what is the feedback for this section? And thank you, everyone. Thank you, guest. You will receive the goodie happy very soon.
That's wonderful. Firstly, I want to thank all our panelists for taking out the time and being here and spending this time to share your insights, your brand stories. And Gulroz Alam, we have to say this was one of the most innovative and interesting moderation of a panel. We really enjoyed it, as a team enjoyed it, and the audience have enjoyed it. So thank you so very much. And yes, if you, all of you are, I'm sure, on Twitter or any social media platforms, if you'd like our guests to say a few words on your questions, then please go ahead and ask them that, tagging them with our hashtag ScreenAge. So with that, I want to thank all of you for being here on ScreenAge with you once again from the entire team at ScreenAge Media. Thank you very much.